The Lord be with you.
And also
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Amen, amen, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains just a grain of wheat. But if it dies, it produces much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will preserve it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there also will my servant be. Whoever honors and serves me, the Father will honor." The Gospel of the Lord. My parents, they tried really hard to childproof my house. They really did. But that didn't seem to matter. See, my brother and sister were disaster areas. Hurricane David and Tropical Storm Laura, you could call them. Always injuring themselves, broken this, strained that, torn apart, whatever. Like there was a time that my brother was just rocking in his little rocking chair and he tipped it back too far and he hit the back of his head on the mantle of the fireplace. 17 stitches. This is the time that my sister stuck her hand into the turning chain of the exercise bike. Tore her hand right open. 52 stitches. Pretty bad, eh? They were always having accidents because they were always so rambunctious and curious and so into everything. You know, they were little chimpanzees. I was not like that. See, my curiosity ended when I was just 2 years old and I stuck a glad wire twist tie into a wall socket. That'll do it, that's for sure. Some of you are saying, ooh, and some of you are saying, oh. That explains everything, Father Mike. The hair, the dog, the Pepsi, the speeding tickets, everything. It fits so well into that little hole, you know? Not that I remember very much from the incident. My parents were downstairs at the time. They were cleaning or something. And suddenly, from upstairs, they heard this loud bang, 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 bang. I know. They looked at each other, ran up the stairs to find the carpet in front of the wall socket was on fire. And I had been thrown 50 feet through the air into the living room, landing upside down on the Chesterfield, saying, "Whoa, mommy, flashing lights." To which they went, "Wah!" So I went, "Wah!" And they rushed me to the hospital, make sure that I still had all my brains. Apparently the results are still inconclusive on that one. And I had third-degree burns all over my right hand. In fact, it stunted the growth in my right thumb. It's about a half an inch shorter than my left. So you can take a closer look after Mass if you're interested, or not totally grossed out by that, eh? This is my smiting thumb, by the way. I can smite you with this thumb. So there you go. From that day on, I was terrified of flash photography. Any flash and I just freak out. All I had to do was take my picture and I turned into a scene from The Exorcist. Head spinning, arms and legs flailing, Tourette syndrome, the whole works, you know? Every family photo we have from that era is a picture of Mom, Dad, my brother David, and Blur. Freaked out. Eventually, it became a fear of anything with little lights flashing. New stereos, microwave ovens, you name it. I was afraid of it. And I also became terrified of death. See, I came very close to death that day. Somehow I knew it too, even though I was only 2 years old. So I had bad dreams about dying. Whenever there was a ghost on TV, I hid my face, so I ran out of the room. Even Casper the Friendly Ghost had me freaked out. Death and flashing things, which for me meant death. Death, that's our topic for today. A lot of us are afraid of death. We don't deal with death too well in our culture. We fixate on images of immortality and youth and strength and vitality, you know? Like Miley Cyrus and Britney Spears and Arnold Schwarzenegger and Father Michael Moreau, you know? Strong and vital and we want to avoid death, you know? We don't want to talk about death. Even the sick people on TV shows usually look pretty good in all their makeup, you know? Other cultures, when someone dies, they plop the dead person right there on the dining room table for a week, which is gross. But they really let themselves grieve, you know? They let themselves experience the death. We don't even like to talk about it. We don't even like to think about it. When someone dies, we gotta get back to work as fast as we can so no one knows that it bothers us, you know? Pretend it didn't happen. We don't even like using the word death or dead. We say they passed away. They passed on. They passed over. They just passed. Or they're resting in peace. They're deceased. No more. In a better place. They bought the farm, kicked the bucket, pushing up daisies, sleeping with the fishes, taking a dirt nap. That was one I heard recently. You know, that's a bad one, eh? We don't like talking about death. We don't like it at all. Maybe why so many old folks at the seniors' homes, they don't get a lot of visits, you know? We don't want to be reminded that this is where we are all headed. Everything that lives dies. We're all going to die, everyone here, at some point. In fact, as I say this, likely many of you are tensing up while you're sitting there thinking about it, or don't want your kids to hear. You want to cover up their ears, which just proves my point. We're afraid of death. Anyway, back to my fear of death and flashing things. A family friend of mine helped me cure it. It was one night in 1976, 2 years later. Father Walter Fitzgerald, some of you may have heard of him. He had baptized me, actually. He was close to our family. I remember he always smelled like pipe smoke. I still remember that to this day. Anyway, he was really into audiovisual gadgets and gizmos. I think if he could live in a radio shack, he'd be a happy guy. And he was visiting. He was over for supper, and he wanted to show my parents this new gadget, this new invention that he had brought with him, called a video cassette recorder. We had never seen anything like it. It was that long, that tall, weighed about 200 pounds. The tapes were about the size of this book and could record about 10 minutes worth of programs. It was amazing. So we started hooking this thing up to the back of the TV, and right on cue, I freaked out, hollering, screaming, crying, head spinning, spoken Latin backwards, the whole nine yards, you know? And Father Fitzgerald looked at me, and he kept on doing what he was doing. He didn't care. Just kind of ignored me, basically. A pastoral approach, which I have found very effective to this day, as a matter of fact. And after about 10 minutes, after he was finished, and I saw that I wasn't going to be thrown across the room and set the carpet on fire, followed by my parents freaking out, I calmed down. Because I was forced to face my fear. So I overcame it. And I calmly stared blankly into the TV. And I've been staring blankly into the TV ever since. The same thing goes for all of us. Only we need to come to terms. The only way to come to terms with death is to face it. I always thought of myself as a good Catholic. As a kid and a teenager, you know, I said how much I believed in God and Jesus and heaven and the resurrection, but it was all pretty theoretical for me, you know? It wasn't until my best friend Greg died when I was 19. That's when the rubber hit the road. I really had to ask, do I really believe this stuff or not? Because if Greg was anywhere, he was in heaven. So where heaven is, what it is, became the most practical, most urgent things that I needed to know, and I needed to know them now. Maybe this is one of the scariest things about death. It challenges us and forces us to ask, do we really believe the things that we say that we believe here in church every Sunday? I think about this when I'm out at Camp Encounter, walking around at the old cemetery that we have there at the north part of the property. Someday, this body that you're looking at right now and all its vitality like Arnold Schwarzenegger, these arms, these legs, these muscles, these brains, will be buried there. And that kind of gives me the creeps. Even as a priest, I find that scary. The reason horror movies are scary is because death is scary. The thought of losing the ones we love, that's scary. Even heaven is scary because we don't know what it's like. But we're going to have to face it because it's part of life. So just like Father Fitzgerald did for me with the flashing lights, Jesus is going to pull all of us through our fear. In fact, that's what that cross is. He goes through it with us. He goes through it for us. Do you remember learning about life cycles in school? Everything that lives goes through a life cycle, like butterflies. You know, they start off as eggs, and then they become these larvae, these sick little worms or slugs or caterpillars that eat everything in sight. And then they become pupa, which is like a cocoon stage. And then finally they hatch out of that cocoon and become an adult. Able to make their own eggs, and then they die. The circle of life, right? The circle of life, I think that's what they call it. Other animals have life cycles too. So do plants, you know, going from seeds to a shrubbery and so on and so forth, you know? And humans are just like butterflies. We start as eggs inside of our mommies, then we get born. Then the kids and the teenagers, that's the larva stage, when they're all stinky and dirty and, you know, and they're eating everything in sight. And sometimes they have the pupa stage, like I did, where I got stuffed in my locker for 3 years in junior high school. And then they emerge as adults, you know, ready to make their own babies, and then they die. And that's it. The life cycle. The human life cycle. Birth, grow up, death. That's all. Only guess what Jesus did. He changed everything. As a human, he changed the human life cycle. Because he was born, grew up, died, and then he rose. And because he was human, just like us, now we can be just like him, children of God, with eternal life. But only once we accept and go through that death. See, death is not God's will. It's not God's will that the life that he took so much pride in creating should end. It's not God's will that love that we share with each other should be blocked or obstructed or interrupted by anything. That we should be separated from the ones we love and the ones who love us. Our tears are not God's will. And God doesn't want us to be afraid. And that's why Jesus came to destroy death, to swallow up death forever, to conquer death with infinite, all-powerful love. That means that the ones we loved and lost aren't really dead. They're with God. And because they are with God, they can still be with us. That means that we will see them again when we cross that threshold into the next world. And we don't need to be afraid of death because Jesus went before us and showed us that heaven really isn't all that bad. And that means that love is the greatest power in the universe. And nothing, not even death, can conquer love. Because God is love. Amen.